last 4 weeks, we have been getting lots of patients of mucormycosis. It's a really very old disease. For last few days, we are getting lots of cases of the mucormycosis. We will start from very basics. What is mucormycosis? Mucormycosis is a fungal infection that is caused by the group of the fungi called mucormycetes. The molds of these fungi are normally present in environments, so generally it doesn't infect every individual every time, but in the hospitalized patients who are on immunosuppressants, some steroids, diabetes, long-standing hospital stays, who are on mechanical ventilation, oxygen therapies, who got the tocilizumab injections, are at risk of getting mucormycosis. Mucormycosis is a type of the fungal infection that is invasive fungal infections, because it has propensity of the invader. It will invade the bones, soft tissue, brains, and every possible organs nearby. So it's a very big deal. Now, the important thing for us is how to diagnose a patient of mucormycosis, or when should we suspect the mucormycosis. There are basically three kinds of the category we should keep in mind. One is possible mucormycosis category, second is a probable mucormycosis category, and third one is a proven mucormycosis category. There are possible cases which have high likelihood of getting mucormycosis. Possible means that patient has possibility of getting mucormycosis. The criteria is patients who got the COVID-19 disease in last 6 weeks, patients who are the steroids, patients who have some other immunosuppressive therapy, patients who are diabetic, patients who got the mechanical ventilations, patients who got some sort of oxygen therapy. These are all the possible cases they may get the mucormycosis. So what should take care, we should take care in this kind of cases that I will explain. Second category is a probable cases. Probable cases means who has the symptoms of the mucormycosis and that has been confirmed with the some sort of the radiological investigation, that is CT scan or MRI. Proven cases means that has been proven with the some biopsy or culture study. Now we will start with the symptoms of the mucormycosis. Generally starts with the nasal cavity. There are the four stages for the mucormycosis. Stage 1 is limited to nasal cavity. Stage 2 is limited to sinuses.
Second is cases that are limited to sinuses, stage 1, 2. Stage 3 means disease that is limited to orbit. Stage 4 means limited to brain. What are the symptoms of the stage 1? Stage 1 means limited to nasal cavity. First symptom is a nasal crusting, that is the first symptom of the mucormycosis, blockade of nasal, black nasal discharge, epistasis, or nasal heaviness. When it goes to the sinuses, patient complains of the either of the symptoms. Some patient complains of the severe pain in the maxillary area, frontal area, or some side of the face. Some patients complains of the paresthesia or no sensation in touchings. When it goes to the frontal sinus and the ethmoid sinus, some patient complains of the watering of the nose. Then it goes to the orbital cavity. What are the symptoms of the orbital cavity? What is watering of the nose, watering of the eye, proptosis of the eyeball, redness, ecchymosis of the eyeball. When it goes to the brain, then it will be the severe headache, convulsion may happen. Now, next is how to diagnose case of the mucormycosis. I have explained there are three categories. One is a possible. All our physicians should keep the possibility of the mucormycosis in mind who have been treated with the some sort of the steroids, patients who are diabetic, patients who got the oxygen therapy, patients who got the mechanical ventilations. All these patients should we have possibility of mucormycosis in mind when patient developed some sort of the symptoms. Close observation of the all these patients every 72 hours is must. First and most important investigation is CT scan or MRI, PNS or brain with contrast. When CT scan and MRI is normal in possible cases, we should repeat every third or fourth day. When CT scan and MRI shows the possibility of mucormycosis, that is mucosal thickening, blockade of the frontoid ethmoidal recess, proptosis, then we should go for the nasal endoscopy and biopsy. In nasal endoscopy, we will find a mucordiscide, mucopurulent discharge. Sometimes there is a definite black fungus is there. We will take a biopsy or a swab study or KOH-90. Once we get a confirmed diagnosis of the mucormycosis, then we go for the treatment part. Treatment part, we have treated nearly 50 to 60 cases in last 3 weeks. Earlier we used to operate patients, but now we have realized over period that first and most important thing is antifungal drugs. Any proven cases, we should first start the admit the patient, first start the antifungal drugs after diabetic control. We have made a team of the 6 to 7 specialties. Myself, I do the radical part of the mucormycosis surgery. We have the team of the ENT surgeons, that is Dr. Bar, Dr. Mohit, Dr. Hardik. We have the team of the infectious disease specialist. Dr. Kamal sir, he is looking at the amphotericin and related renal toxicity. And we have the team of the our COVID care specialist, Dr. Amit Bhai, Dr. Balguni Man, Dr. Hardik Bhai, and Dr. Vinesh Bhai, and all other, Harendra Bhai. So, and we have the huge support from the ophthalmologists. So it's a teamwork. Surgical part is only 10 to 20% part of the treatment. Rest part is a control of the diabetes, antifungal treatment, and each and every antifungal drugs has propensity for some sort of the renal failure. So we need close monitoring of the renal function test. So when we get a probable or possible or proven cases of the mucormycosis, we admit them, we confirm our diagnosis with CT scan, nasal endoscopy. We admit these patients, we do first diabetes control, and if some patients has also some sort of the active COVID disease, then we simultaneously do the COVID team refer. Once patient is stabilized, we start the antifungal treatment. After stabilization of, and 1 to 2 days of the antifungal treatment, we consider for the surgical treatment. Surgical treatment is of basically two types. One is endoscopic treatment, another is a surgical radical treatment. Most of the patients who require endoscopic sinus surgery, that is functional endoscopic sinus surgery, they do the removal of the turbinates, removal of the sinus, removal of the nasal septum, debridement of the all major sinuses, the maxillary, sphenoid, ethmoid, and frontal sinuses. And sometimes we also do the removal of the middle wall of the orbit. So the most of the patients, then they will get treated with the endoscopic sinus surgery. Some patients, they do come with the loss of vision. So I do the orbital excentration. Some patient has a huge involvement of the maxilla, then we also do unilateral or bilateral maxillectomy. Till now we have operated around 50 cases. 30 cases has been operated by me. They required orbital excentration and maxillectomy. 20 cases has been done by the team of the ENT surgeons. They have been nice with just a endoscopic sinus surgery. Now there is a dilemma in some cases who presented with some sort of the orbital symptoms, but patient has vision. Vision is intact. When vision is intact, but patient has fixed eyeball or the limited mobility of the eyeball, then we do take help of the this things he will guide us.
There are very few cases where there is orbital involvement but the vision is preserved. In such cases, there is a role of trans amphotericin B injection. So it can be given in very small amount of patients where only muscles are involved or only apex of the orbit is involved. Most of the patients coming to us are in the later stage that at this stage the injection is not very beneficial. But the early stage when eyeball is intact, vision is good, then at that time we can give in amphotericin B in the orbital cavity 3.5 mg per ml on 3 consecutive days or according to the response seen in first phase. So this is the only thing where ophthalmological part is intervening in the treatment protocol. Rest, many of the cases coming to me in OPD are certain having like watering of eye, history of COVID in past, with mild blurring of vision or mild maxillary pain, and on MRI they see the signs of fungal infection. So it is just on OPD basis where I see patient coming walking in and they get admitted for surgery or further treatment. So for all the consultants, I'll just say that look for any signs of mucormycosis, because patient generally don't complain it as a severe thing. Just watering or just mild blurring, they come for power of glasses and then they give history of COVID and then have symptoms. Next, I'll say Dr. Amit will explain better what is the medical part of the treatment.
Like already about the risk factor. One more thing I mentioned about the risk factor. One is iron. Uses of iron, dex pyroswimming, uses of iron leads to the more vulnerable for the mucormycosis. One another drug is a voriconazole. Voriconazole uses also leads to the more prone for the mucormycosis. So what we are doing right now, we are giving the antifungal voriconazole as an empirical therapy. So that is, use of voriconazole is also a risk factor for the mucormycosis. So just like if it is serum galactomelan is positive, then we have to use the voriconazole. So because voriconazole itself is a risk factor for the mucormycosis. So one thing, already he mentioned about the diabetic patient. One more, like we saw the stem cell transplant patient and a post renal transplant patient. So post renal transplant patient have a higher risk factor for the to develop the mucormycosis. And third one is a severe neutropenia. So another severe neutropenia, it's a risk factor for developing of mucormycosis. So apart from the diabetes, uses of the steroid, the post renal transplant patient, severe neutropenia, and the use of iron or the voriconazole, which are the risk factor for the mucormycosis. So that is about the risk factor. One another thing, the practice, because mucormycosis from the soil, not from the air. So most of from the soil or from the water that will be contaminated. So what I like in Krishna Selvi, till now only 2-3 patients have developed the mucormycosis. Other have not developed mucormycosis, because what we practice over there in our ICU, we are not putting any water into the for the O2 in the O2 flow meter. So all O2 are the dry O2. So it's a water or the saline, because that recommended the saline you have to put in the flow meter. But we are not sure about the hygiene. So they are sometimes attendant put the water inside the flow meter. Because ideally that flow meter should be the autoclave once in a day. And second, we have to put the saline in that. And then we can use the saline in a flow meter, and that humidifier is required, but we have no control in that. So what we are doing right now, dry air only. So only dry, so no saline or no water in a flow meter.
So you don't see humidified oxygen nowadays?
Yes. Non-humidifier. Ideally in the critical care, in an ICU, not required water or saline in a flow meter. So by this way, we are still able to less number of cases of the mucormycosis in the Krishna Selvi. Right now, I think 2 or 3 cases we documented. Here, what we are getting from the other center, we are getting the patient for the mucormycosis. So this is another the risk factor. Another my observation is a steam inhalation. Steam inhalation is also not recommended, because steam itself is caused water in fogging inside the mouth or in the nasal cavity. So that is also leads to the mucormycosis. So I strongly against the steam inhalation. So again, that is a risk factor for those.
It helps in humidification, not dryness, because dryness creates
not dry. Because what अत्यारे जितना भी पेशेंट हमें विदाउट एयर या विदाउट ह्यूमिडिफिकेशन मैनेज कर रहे हैं तो कोई पेशेंट में कोई कंप्लीट नहीं है. एंड इवन विद द बैक पैक
इट इज ओनली द वन फैक्टर इट इज
There is also high risk because it is
or not even check that patient. They feel that the another important neutropenia or thrombocytopenia might be very few cases, but I feel that might be this coronavirus also develop or something bone marrow insult. We are still not proved. I had done one or two patients. Initially, the first phase, even one patient from Krishna has been shifted to SG, where they doubt that there may be a bone marrow suppression. Young men, post-corona, and patient admitted is now recovered. But that patient, again, we feel, we done a bone marrow also, and we feel. But still, the question about the incidence of neutropenia, or how much bone marrow insult, is really a question.
Bhavya sir, I have discussed with one of the sir, he told me, see, diabetes is not a sole factor. There is something with this variant of the COVID-19, there must be biostatistics and there must be some theory of this variant with the immunity. In lots of diabetes specialists, they must be getting in patient with diabetes, ketoacidosis, some patients in coma, but they are not getting the liquor. This variant with the some immunity.
Like what we are discussing about the diabetes and sugar, but we have to think about the from where he will get the mucus. So that is the source. I am talking about the source. Source is the water and the soil. So both the things, only not only the diabetes and the sugar, the play the role of the mucormycosis to develop. But what they get the oxygen humidifier from the soil, from the hygiene, because there is nothing like the
thermometer in niche da ka matlab varsho di kam
nahi hai. My question is that here is pulse zero to so many people, they are also getting the same oxygen, why they are not developing? And alopone to kitna ochu steroid that compared to that pulse zero,
because they ko kada kada bachat di hua patient
na na
je pulse therapy wala patient ase ne ek kada chapni sudhi etle sudhi nama chale nahi hua ki apne mucor develop thai.
આપણે 10,000 કારણ કે આપણે એવા ટેવાયેલા છે કે આપણે 11,000 કે ઇન્ફેક્શન છે અથવા 10,000, પણ કોક પેશન્ટ જેને ખરેખર 4,000, એટલે ખરેખર તો આપણે રેટ્રોગ્રેડલી જોવું જોઈએ કે આ બધા મ્યુકર વાળા પેશન્ટોના ખરેખર જે પોસ્ટ કોવિડ અથવા ડ્યુરિંગ કોવિડ કેટલા કાઉન્ટ થયા
છે. બીજું 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 અનધર થિંગ્સ નોટ not any ward patient develop the mucormycosis. What the patient develop the mucormycosis, those who are in ICU or those who are in the O2. So there is a relation between the immunity, like immunosuppression, and the sun source. So source is right now it's a water, because only diabetic patient without oxygen patient will not develop the mucormycosis.
So that is a source. Patient they receive steroid for other illnesses, they didn't develop that commonly.
Like the both the way, source and the immunity.
Doesn't come in contact with the infection, how will you get the infection?
Yes. Because the mucor is not like inside the body, and immunity down then the mucor will come up. It's not like that.
Suppressor there, but if it doesn't come across with any infection, they will not get the infection.
Now nasal sinus ka yahan je bhi maxillary sinus ka je bhi location se એવું ભી બની શકે ને મેડમ છે કે કોઈને ડાયરેક્ટ આઈ માં ભી મ્યુકોર આવ્યું હોય. ઓપ્થેલ્મોમાં મ્યુકોર માઇક્રોસિસ જે ભી ઇમ્યુનો કોમ્પ્રોમાઇઝ થઈ જાય એચઆઈવી ડાયરેક્ટ ઓપ્થેલ્મો તો નથી થતી.
એટલે બીજા ઓર્ગન જે મેં દેતા નથી થતા એટલે માઇનસ
થાય એટલે એન્ડ પોઈન્ટ મેચ હોય છે. માઇનસ
માઇનસ ઓર્ગન છે આઈ સુધી ઇક્વડ એને it may have an
effect. Do you see any solitary eye involvement?
They have sinus
involvement. Mainly nodal, there is a dental.
They have sinus
involvement. So now move forward. These are all about the risk factor. Now,
excuse me, can we show some cases of we have got on the...
Yes.
We have few cases of our institute.
Yes. So till now...
Sir, we got two cases of the skin mucormycosis.
Yes. So like again I emphasize on that the four types, basically four types. It is one is a like a rhinocerebral, second one is a cutaneous, third one is a pulmonary, and a fourth one is a disseminated, means in the blood. So all we are getting it's a rhinocerebral. But we are forget about the GI complaint. Most of patients in our ICU, they have a GI complaint, but we don't have any modality to diagnose the GI mucormycosis. Right now we are getting the diagnosis about the rhinocerebral only. Even for the disseminated, means blood mucormycosis, we are not identified whether it's how we are to identify. So these are the other...
But in our institute also there are 3 or 4 cases where GI perforation also done post-COVID, and we have done the intestinal resection also. But most of the time they feel it is a necrotizing, but they have not actually find out whether it was a mucor or not. Because at that time we are not that much
clear. હવે આપણે એવું કરવું જોઈએ કે જેવી GI સર્જરી થાય એનું તમે ટિશ્યુ એટલીસ્ટ
અને એ લોકો બધાનું ઇવન પોસ્ટ ઓપરેટિવ એ લોકો કે અમે સ્ટીક બી નહીં લઈએ કારણ કે અમને ડાઉટ છે કે આ ઇન્ફેક્શન કદાચ થશે વધશે અને શબ્દ એવો જ લખે છે કે નેક્રોટાઇઝિંગ ઇન્ટેસ્ટાઇન કે કોલાઇટિસ.
અગેન જીઆઈ ઇઝ લાઈક વાય ફોર ધ મ્યુકર અગેન ધેટ કન્ટેન ધ વોટર ધ ફ્લુઇડ કન્ટેન એન્ડ ધ ઇમ્યુનિટી ઇઝ ડાઉન ધેટ વિલ ઓલસો ડેવલપ. વન માય પેશન્ટ ડેવલપ ધ લાઈક બ્લિસ્ટર્સ over here. I'm sending today like the biopsy of that. So, well, let's see your cutaneous. I don't know.
પણ બાયોપ્સી સિવાય એટલે હિસ્ટોપેથો સિવાય મ્યુકોરમાઇકોસિસ ડાયગ્નોસ થાય એટલે કલ્ચરમાંથી થઈ શકે
એ ફંગલ કલ્ચરમાંથી કલ્ચર આપણે કદાચ નથી કરી રહ્યા બાકી
ફંગલ
થાય લોકો બધા હિસ્ટોપેથો રિપોર્ટ જ આપે
ના કેવોસ પ્રિપરેશન આપણે જોઈએ છે કેવોસ પ્રિપરેશનમાં અને અનધર ઇઝ અ બાયોપ્સી એટલે
એમાં
છે આપણે
હા પાડ્યા હોય તો કંઈક ડિફરન્સ કે કંઈક જલ્દી ખબર પડી અથવા કંઈક બી એમાં છે નહીં એવું કંઈક ડિફરન્સ
એટલે કેવો સ્ટેન થી આપણને અત્યારે તો કહે છે
પેશન્ટ ઇઝ ઓલરેડી એડમિટેડ nasal orbital mucormycosis with the lung orbital mucormycosis.
લંગ ડાયગ્નોસિસ નો ઇશ્યુ છે આપણે એટલે વેધર વી કેન લાઈક ધ સિટી થોરેક્સ માંથી આપણને કંઈક ગાઈડ મળે તો અધરવાઇઝ વી કેન નોટ ટેક ધ લાઈક
બ્રોન્કોસ્કોપી ગાઈડ છે કે
બ્રોન્કોસ્કોપી આમાં શું છે બ્રોન્કોસ્કોપી ઇઝ લાઈક વેરી રિસ્કી ઇન ધીસ પેશન્ટ એક વખત બ્રોન્ક ગયું ને એટલે પછી બ્લીડિંગ થાય જ રાખે પાછળ પેશન્ટ એટલે પછી નથી મજા
ઇન્વેસિવ કોઈ બી કરવું એના કરતા બેટર કે નોન
આમાં એટલી મ્યુકોઝા થીન હોય છે ને કે ઇવન સક્શન બી કરીએ છીએ ને આપણે પેશન્ટોમાં એટલે પછી એમને બ્લીડિંગ ચાલુ જ થઈ જાય કારણ કે ઓલરેડી આપણો ક્લેક્ઝન ચાલતું હોય છે બીઓડી અથવા બીડી ડોઝમાં અને એની ગ્લુકોઝ એટલી લીન એન્ડ થીન પ્લસ સ્ટીરોઇડ ચાલતા હોય એટલે જો તમારું પછી બ્લીડિંગનો ઇશ્યુ બહુ ચાલુ થઈ જાય
તમારે એટીપિકલ ફંગલ માટેના કોઈ બ્લડના કોઈ
ના એટલે ખાલી આપણે મ્યુકોરમાઇકોસિસ માટે નોટ એન બ્લડ એક ખાલી આપણે ગેલેક્ટોમેન એન 1-3 બીટાડી ગ્લુકેન મૂકીએ છીએ દેટ ઇઝ ફોર ધ એસ્પર્જિલોસિસ એટલે હવે વોટ આઈ સ્ટાર્ટેડ એટલે વેરિકોનાઝોલના બી અમુક આયા છે કે વેરિકોનાઝોલ ઇન્ડ્યુસ્ડ મ્યુકોરમાઇકોસિસ તો હવે એવું કરવું પડે છે કે જો ગેલેક્ટોમેનન પોઝિટિવ હોય તો જ વોરિકોનોઝોલ ચાલુ કરવાની એમ્પિરિકલ વોરિકોનોઝોલ ચાલુ જ નહીં કરવાની તમે એમ્પિરિકલ ફ્લુકોનોઝોલ આપી શકો છો પણ દેટ ઇઝ નો ઇફેક્ટ ઓન ધ મ્યુકર અને નોટ ઇફેક્ટ ઓન ધ એસ્પર્જિલોસિસ એન્ટીબાયોટિક્સ એન્ટીબાયોટિક્સ ઓલસો લીડ્સ ટુ ધ ડેવલપમેન્ટ ઓફ ધ મ્યુકરમાઇન એની ફંગલ ઇન્ફેક્શન
આપણે તો સીટી માં છે ને કેરેક્ટરિસ્ટિક સાઇન રિવર્સ હેલો ને
એક્ઝેક્ટલી કોમન કે ફંગલ ઓર ધ કન્સર્ન લાઈક ફંગલ ઓર ધ ડેવિડિટી ડેવલપમેન્ટ
નો લાઈક ઇફ ધેર ઇઝ અ ફંગલ ઇન્ફેક્શન એન્ડ કેન સસ્પેક્ટ ઓફ લંગ ઇઝ ઓલસો ઇન ધેટ ફંગલ ઇન્ફેક્શન
બટ ધેટ ઇઝ So
like this is about the risk factor and the diagnosis. Now we'll discuss about the treatment part. Already Dharmesh bhai told about the like surgical and the medical. Like last way what happened, we are doing only medical treatment, no surgical. This time we are doing both the things, surgical as well as the medical. So that's why we are getting some better results. બીકોઝ લાસ્ટ ટાઈમ જેટલા બી પેશન્ટ હતા જેટલા બી મેં ઇન્ફોટેશન બી પર રાખેલા છે કે નોટ સર્વાઈવ રાઈટ નાવ વી હેવ પેશન્ટ લાઈક એક મહિનાથી દોઢ મહિનાથી પેશન્ટ છે હજી આપણી જોડે વિથ ધ એન્ડોસ્કોપી વિથ ધ યુઝ ઓફ ધ સર્જિકલ ડેબ્રામેન્ટ વિથ ધ યુઝ ઓફ ધ ફેસ એન્ડ ઓલસો સાયમલ્ટેનિયસલી
ઇન્ફોટેશન
લાઈક ઓનલી વન પેશન્ટ આઈ એન્કાઉન્ટર્ડ વિથ ધ વન ન્યુરોલોજીકલ કોમ્પ્લિકેશન આઈ એમ નોટ અબાઉટ ધ અધર પેશન્ટ એક તો આપણી જોડે અત્યારે લિમિટેડ ઓપ્શન્સ છે એક તો લાઇકોસોમલ એમ્ફોટેરિસિન ઇઝ નોટ અવેલેબલ સો એનો જે ડોઝ છે એકચ્યુઅલી એનાથી આપણે બહુ લો ડોઝ આપી રહ્યા છે સો ધ પીપલ એટલે લાઈક ઓલમોસ્ટ 6 to 8 mg પર કેજી ડોઝ રિક્વાયર્ડ મીન્સ જો પેશન્ટ છે તો 250 to 350 mg પર ડે ડોઝ ઇઝ રિક્વાયર્ડ ફોર ધ પેશન્ટ બટ
આવે તો 3 આપવા પડે
નહીં 50 નું આવે તો આપણે 6 આપવા પડે 6 એટલે ઓલમોસ્ટ એટલું આપણે 8000 એમઆરપી છે તો ઓલમોસ્ટ 848 50000 પર ડે કોસ્ટ છે ખાલી ડ્રગ થેરાપીની
અને એવા 40 દિવસ પહેલા
એટલે એમાં એવું છે કે 21 ડેઝ 30 ડેઝ અને 6 વીક એટલે આપણે 21 ડેઝ એ ડિસાઈડ કરીએ કે એને 6 વીકની જરૂર છે કે નહીં એટલે મિનિમમ ઇઝ 21 ડેઝ and maximum is a 6-week therapy for the total amphotericin B, liposomal amphotericin. Another option is like plain amphotericin B, we can use lipid complex and the plain, but they have a higher risk for the like kidney disease and the liver involvement, like liver injury. So we are more towards the liposomal amphotericin B, but the availability is an issue right now. So another two drug we have, one is a isomuconazole and another is a fosaconazole. So isobuconazole is a Pfizer like Cresemba, it's a tablet oral, also the injectable is available, again it's a costly therapy, but it's not the replacement of the amphotericin B basically, it's like the adjuvant, if it is patient develop the AKI or the lung liver injury on the liposomal amphotericin B, then that is a switch over therapy, it's like the Cresemba, it's isobuconazole. It's a tablet as well as the injectable is available. But in the guideline, it's not like the first line drug of therapy. It's like the second line or either it's a switch over therapy. Because these are the patient like amphotericin B that develop the AKI. So then after we cannot give the like, because right now we have one patient also on the 21 days of liposomal amphotericin B. Now patient on the dialysis. So now what to do? So then we can switch over to this isobuconazole or the fosaconazole.
So what we usually see in routine sinusitis like now show the images. These are the images of the sinuses where the hyperintense mucosal thickening in the maxillary sinuses. In this images, the mucosal thickening in the maxillary sinuses by hyperintense and even it is hypo or isointense one T1, which is normal, like we usually see in the routine sinusitis or the rhinitis and the allergic sinusitis. Next. So, this is the known case of Bukor mycosis, like we have the mucosal thickening, hyperintense mucosal thickening in the right maxillary sinus, inferior sinus, frontal sinus and the nasal cavity. If you see the inferior terminates, they are also hypertrophied and hyperintense. Opposite side, minimal mucosal thickening. In the axial images, we have that the mucosal thickening in the inferior sinuses and extension of this extension into the orbit, which is seen along the medial wall of orbit and at the apex, hyperintense pain, hyperintensity. This is the extension of the
mucor in the orbit. Another one, like, you know, we have this case, the same like with the fluid level in the maxillary sinus, mucosal thickening, loculation, air, and the involvement of the soft tissue of the infratemporal fossa, which is like, you know, temporalis muscle, which is hyperintense enhancing temporalis muscle. This is the extension of the mucor into the infratemporal fossa and the temporalis muscle. This is operated case. Anu naam shu cha
pishu tamaru cha
Shyam. This is the operated case where it shows the extension of the mucor in the infratemporal fossa, right side infratemporal fossa. Necrosis of the, quite extensive necrosis of the tissue in the infratemporal fossa, and enhancement of the dura in the brain on the right hemisphere, on the right side. So this is what the pachymeningitis. This is extension of that mucor into the sinuses. Next.
So, this patient has developed a small abscess.
Another patient that.
Shyam, Shyam, you know?
Haan, I know, chai, biju scan, chai, I know, biju scan.
Chai, biju scan,
this is the, you know, again operated case, left maxillary sinus nasal cavity, ethmoid mucosal thickening, minimal extension into the orbit on left side. But in this case, we find like ring lesions in the right frontal lobe, which is atypical of the mucor mycosis. It could be another fungal infection. Ew, mane lage. The mucor doesn't show this type of lesion. Ah, same pillow, tame keda ne abscess.
Kya jama?
This is the abscess. This is the intracranial extension. Operated case, infratemporal necrosis and the abscess in right temporal region. This one is the infratemporal abscess and necrosis. This one is the necrosis, right infratemporal fossa. This is the surgical right maxillary maxillotomy of nasectomy. This is the necrosis. Pachymeningitis, right?
Sir, vadhyo na pehla karta.
And this is, you know, the abscess. This is the abscess. So these are the things, like, you know, extension of the lesion in the different area. Next. The same like multiple ring lesion. This is another patient with the ring lesion, which is not typical of the mucor mycosis. Usually it shows the necrosis in the basal ganglia and the central location. But this is not typical of the mucor mycosis. So, that's fungal infection. Ama, if you see the mucosa in the right maxillary side, shows peripheral enhancement. 6. Mucosa. In this case, mucosa, if you see the enhancement, bottom and T1 postpartum. See the enhancement of the mucosa, which shows peripheral enhancement and the abscess formation in the maxillary sinus. So these are, you know, different type of findings that we are getting in the
dissemination. You have to also look for the lung and liver anywhere.
See, again in this case, like, you know, again in this case, like, you know, there is minimal extension of the mucor into the left orbit along the medial rectus, and it shows the abscess formation or the peripheral enhancement. So even if the sinus is quite a clear, not much infection in the sinus or the not much, but it shows some extension into the orbit. So these are the different patterns that we are getting.